Hi, how are you? Good morning. My name is Nag Ashwin. I am a filmmaker. So I think part of this talk, part of this idea, part of this discussion will be about how I became a filmmaker. Because for all practical purposes, I should not be a filmmaker. I was born into a family of like so many doctors, like mother, father, grandfather, aunt, uncle, everybody were doctors. And the odd one or two people who were not doctors were engineers. So the chance of me doing anything else was quite small. And this was not now, this was like, you know, when I finished my 10th, it was 2000. So 2000 happens to be almost 19 years ago now that you think about it. So back then the thought of doing anything else was really hard. And when I figured out that I wanted to do something to do with writing, and then film seemed like a very, I always liked film and cinema because everybody likes to watch cinema. They have their favorite actors and actresses and songs. Everybody loves cinema. But the idea to want to be a filmmaker or to want to make movies is very hard for somebody who doesn't have any connection to the industry, because it's like a different world. So that much dreaming I didn't do at that point. I thought I'll become a writer, thought I'll do journalism, and I got into a mass comm college. But all the stories I wrote as a journalist were all fictional, so I started making up stories. So I somehow along the process realized this is not a good, I won't make a good journalist. So then I went into advertising, and then after a while I realized I can't keep selling soaps and beer and toothpaste. Like all my creativity can't go into that. So I thought I'll move on. And then I did quite a few things. I worked in an email call center for Amazon for some time. And that basically means you write back emails to customer complaints. So they'll be like, where is my box? Why didn't it come? So then I'll buy, you know, yeah, I feel your pain. You know, even I had a box once, I didn't get it. And, you know, I'll give it back to you after in due time. So, you know, I used to try to be creative in whatever I do. And slowly, after a very long time, I found my way into being an assistant director for a Telugu film. And as in Telugu films, I mean, like maybe most of you, like you kind of grew up with a diet of like Hollywood and Bollywood, and Telugu, especially at that time, was very, very faction driven back in the 2000s, if you remember. Like there were lots of sumos flying, there were lots of... anyway, so there is a very alien world for me at that point. So it took a while, it took two or three films. I worked under Shekhar Kamla Garu for some time, and slowly I found my way into making films. And I think around 2015, like almost 10 years since I finished college, I finally made my first film, which was again not supposed to really happen, because this film was a self-exploratory journey of a selfish businessman in the Himalayas. Like Telugu cinema, like nobody does that kind of stuff. Like it doesn't make any sense. And even if you make it, the chances that it'll even release and make any money is like, you know, it'll probably hear of it in a, you know, some Metro Plus small column somewhere. That's about it. It won't. But somehow that movie worked. It became a hit. And I got a chance to make another film. And I took some more time, and then again I started writing a film which I thought I wanted to, was a story I wanted to tell. So I made a movie on Savitri Garu. Like I always loved watching black and white movies, and almost all the black and white movies I watched had Savitri Garu. The actors used to change, songs used to change, but she was always there. So I always was very curious about her. And then I made a movie about her, and again, it was a movie about like a sort of a self-destructive tragedy journey of superstars, and you don't know how those movies, that movie is not supposed to work. So it makes no sense, like who's going to make a tragedy in Telugu with a female protagonist and think a Telugu audience will watch it. We made it anyway, and it worked, and it that's why you called me here, so I'm standing. So basically, I think first part of the point is like, basically you don't know what works, you just give your best and you do it honestly, because if you have a really good reason from inside and some honest reason to do it, it will work. And if you try to have some calculations like, you know, this chaste that will happen, that will, because of this 5 years from now, that if you make those calculations, high chances that it won't work actually. So So anyway, so basically if you're as clueless as me, maybe it might work. So anyway, so basically that's how I got to be here. And so what I wanted to talk to you about was, why does a movie work is a question that people ask me. Like, sir, like, how did you make this film? Like, how did you think of this scene? Like, what does this work? So, you know, you try to act like you knew what you're doing most of the time. And then you try to act as if you had this plan from the get-go. Yeah, of course, I knew this would be a big hit. But that's, not always true. But I think like when you want to dissect, when you want to really dissect like engineers, you want to dissect like why a film works or why anything, any sort of media or art works. I think it comes down to a point of like when you see something on the screen, like everything is fake, right? First of all, you're sitting in a theater and you know there are like so many heads around you. There's a theater, there's one big beam of light coming there. So it's all fake. And then you know those people are actors. You've seen them in 10 films before. You've seen these people, they've seen them outside. They're all actors. You know there's light that is fake. You know everybody around these people are junior artists who are walking. Everything is a lie on the screen. But if at that moment, like because of the writing or because of the performance or because of whatever, at that moment if you can ignore everything else, okay? You can ignore this hundred of people sitting around you, you can ignore this light, this theater, and you only see that person's eyes, the voice that's coming out of his mouth, and it only that is real, and then you connect. What does connect mean exactly? Like, you know, then you empathize with him, and like if he tells you a joke, if he falls, you laugh, if he cries, you cry with him, and if he falls in love with somebody, you fall in love with the heroine also. It's great. So that's how it works, and sometimes it doesn't work because sometimes it just doesn't connect. So very Inca physics, if you want to go, like I think it basically works on two principles. Like there's one thing called mirror neurons, which basically means that you see something and there's something in your brain called mirror neurons which automatically reflect that thing. So if somebody is, you know, hand is getting cut or something, you'll be like, ah. So that's basically like what that means. And if somebody, you know, hugs you, heroine hug, and you feel awe, that's also a mirror neuron. So that and then if that works, then you get a little hit of dopamine in your brain, which is a hormone. So when both of them work together, a movie works, or an ad works, or a piece of music works, or whatever works, it's because you can connect to them. So connect is a very ambiguous term, so that's why I wanted to put some science into it. So we are at that stage where, back in the day, like, you know, when NTR Garu's time, or even Mahabharata on TV times, it was very easy to trigger off our mirror neurons or dopamine receptors or whatever. Because like whatever, like when God will come on screen, you'll put dhanams, or people will do aarti. It used to be very easy, like, you know, love stories were very easy to believe. But now we have so much content. Now we have so much stuff going on around us that it's very easy. It'll be like, how many did we see? Like, you know, like, what is this? I can see this in my TV. So it becomes a lot harder to get the same effect or to get the same emotion or the response from an audience. So in a way that's good because it ups your quality, and in a way that's bad because you don't know what is going wrong, because you so far are trying the same thing. There's heroine hugging the same way, there's people are chopping the hands the same way, but nobody's caring anymore. And they're like, bah, we've seen this so many times. So that is a realistic problem with what is happening, oversaturation of things, which again I'll segue into. Why is, from 2011 to, say, what, 2018, the number of phones, okay, in India have, like, grown by 10 times, and the number of smartphones in India have grown since, obviously, our geo-revolution has happened a few years back. So, from 2015 to now, 2015 was when I made my first film, Yavade Subramaniam, to Mahanati. In those 3 years, I could see a change in the way people watch films. Back in the day, people used to go, even in the villages, they used to go to the town and get, pirated films onto their phone by SD card and come and watch it at home. But now you have 4G. Now you have 4G where you get almost 1 GB per day for no reason. Like, you don't even know what to do with that much data. So there's so much data, and then you're just watching stuff, and apparently 30% of the country has a smartphone at this point. More than 50% of the India has phones, and those phones are changing into smartphones really fast. So 30% of India have more than 300 million people. That is more population than half of any country in the world. Like, so that's a lot of people who own smartphones with free internet for no reason. So they're watching everything. YouTube has, like, if you watch all the YouTube videos, you have to take so many likes to finish it. Like one yoga has to go, basically. And then there's so much, like, Amazon, Netflix. So anyway, they're watching all of these things, and the entire mindset of a viewer has changed, because for him to actually go to a theater and watch a movie and actually feel something is no longer as easy, because he can watch it when he's in his bathroom, in his room, in his car, in his class. I'm sorry, I'm sure most of you. But wherever, like, you can watch it anywhere, right? So then what is the point? Why will you spend $150 and go and buy popcorn and go watch a movie? So that has become a very interesting juncture, because as this is happening, as your smartphones are increasing and people are watching movies on smartphones or whatever, at the same time, India is building a lot of screens in the theaters. So actually, India has the least number of theaters for the kind of population that we have. We have about 9,000 theaters all over the country, out of which 5,000 are in the four states of South India, 5,500 or something. So, like, the rest of India has to fight for those 4,000 screens that they have up there. So, but we're growing, and China was in the same position. China had about 10,000 screens in 2011 or 12, and now they have 45,000 to 50,000 screens. So in the past 8 years, they've become the number one screen density. But I'm not understanding where the industry will go, because one way we're building screens and saying, come watch movies in theaters. And the other way, everybody has a Jio 4G phone, and where they're watching whatever they want on, Jio or whatever, Sunnext. Anyway, so nobody watches Sunnext. So anyway, that's the problem. So anyway, so when we come back to all of this, major issues, like, you just wonder, like, where 5 years from now this is going to go, because I seem to take 2 or 3 years to make every movie. So by the time I make my next movie, I have no idea how the marketing or how people are going to watch it, or, like, you know, does it always need to be a big, like, you know, Bahubali sort of experience for people to actually go and watch a movie, or can it still be a small 96 sort of romantic movie for people to go to theaters? What is the reason, like, people watch movies? It's because of your mirror neurons and dopamine, like you understood. But you don't understand also, because it's still a bit of magic. So, I still have 4 minutes. So basically the point I'm trying to make is, you know, how many people saw Bahubali in the theaters? Like, you know, because the biggest hit of Indian cinema, right? So it made about 2,000 crores worldwide or something. It's huge. The closest person, not even one quarter that. So, you know, the number of audiences that actually watch Bahubali in the theaters, percentage of Indian population or whatever, it's about 9 to 10%. So that's like, that is with the number of people who saw it repeatedly also. I'm sure there's some people who saw it 4 or 5 times in the theaters and maybe more. So that equals to a 9 to 10% of Indian population. So you just think about the number of people they're not even reaching. And that reach is being covered by the phones. So now, like, where is the Indian film industry going? I have no idea. So the basic point of it is, you have generally no idea of what will happen and how things will go, but just be honest. And if you're honest, I think people will reflect whatever you're trying to convey to them through their mirror neurons or dopamine or whatever. Don't use your phones too much, because they're very addictive, mirror neurons. And, like, you know, every time you get a like on Facebook or Instagram, you get a little hit of dopamine. That's an addiction. Like, you know, it took about hundreds of years for people to study addiction on alcohol and, you know, marijuana, cocaine, whatever. And smartphones have been around for only 7 years. So, you know, like, yeah, it's a very realistic problem. I think maybe 10 years later, somebody else can talk about this, because then they'll have data about it. And till then, I'll just take my leave, and thank you for calling.